Buddy, so today I'll talk to you about the Greek perspective of the First World War. This is a picture, this is an iron actually, because here's the word says peace in 1913, but afterwards, until 1992, it was even more aggressive for this country. So you have the first mention of the Balkan Wars, that everything will come to an end, and then it's worse. So I'll give you some details about this part of history of 18th century. It was probably known, maybe you don't know. So Greece was under occupation by the Ottoman Empire for almost four centuries, which means, if you translate it, that it was almost impossible to have remained a Greek identity. It was really difficult because we are talking about generations and generations under the occupation of Ottomans. So in 1822, the first Hellenic, this is the Greek word for Greece, Hellenic, Hellas, democracy, and then Greece became a kingdom with a Bavarian king, of course. So the main problems that that someone can say that created these tensions in Greece in order to expand was that there was no infrastructure, because actually Greece was just one tiny part of this massive empire. There was no state, so there was no organization. Ottoman Empire was an empire, it wasn't like a modern state, so they had to create it again. As I mentioned, there was no identity, political, national, or cultural identity. Most of the people didn't even speak Greek, so they had to, for some reason, to reinvent themselves to connect with their ancient history. Of course, we're talking about ancient history because there was a massive gap from ancient history to modern history, what they consider as modern history. So ancient history is always very fancy among Greek people. So they have to reinvent their modern identity. It was then that they understood that this is a new state, so we are Greeks, so we are not Turkish or half Turks or whatever they believe. And then the politicians, they created these aspirations for a Western modern Greek state, which this is in Greece in the green part in 1830. So we're talking very, it was almost nothing. It's one third of what it is now. And these are the stages. So you see how it goes. So this is the actual country now, not the third one, the other one. So it took years for the country to gain its territories, what we consider now our territories. Of course, there are always were these aspirations, because ancient Greece was really expanding and was really powerful, and there are Greek people all over the Mediterranean, especially this part of the Mediterranean. Minor Asia primarily, Asia Minor primarily. So that led to the Greco-Turkish war, which it was the aspiration of the king, who was the general as well, that Greece, as it managed to gain all these territories, it was the chance to just go get some more. I can say that, as I see it, it was one of the very few examples of Greek authorities, if I can say that, that they had this idea of expanding. Generally, you can say that it's not, at least in the modern years, it's not a very aggressive nation. So they managed to, they prepare a campaign, so they entered the remains of the Ottoman Empire, and they just, so they won, so they entered and they gained the first parts of which are in the Aegean Sea. So they decided that it was that easy to get in the mainland. Of course, they didn't really understand how big Turkey is. So the way to catastrophe, the aspiration of Greece, they wanted the main ideas that created Greece of two continents, Europe and Asia, and five seas, the Ionian, Aegean, Marmara Sea, Libyan, and Black Sea. So this was the idea connected to the ancient, years, ancient Greece, which was actually Greek all over this place. Of course, we're talking for an army then and now and ever. Greece is a small country with not a large population, so we're talking about really tired soldiers. Let's say I have a personal experience with my great grandfather, that he was a soldier for 10 years. So you can imagine that. It wasn't only that they were tired, they were less, far less. So of course the number and the morale of Turkish people was higher because they have someone invading their country. So of course they had a better reason to fight back. It's impressive if someone examines the atrocities for both sides. Probably Greek people, especially when they entered they reached Ankara, these places, they were so, let's say, some of them, there are sources that say that some of the soldiers got crazy. They were just killing even the fellow Greeks, so people were really tired, you know, fighting for years for almost no reason. So this led, one of the main things, to the catastrophe of Smyrna, which led to the Treaty of Lausanne. So to move to, after the information I gave, to the refugee crisis, there were massive waves of refugees. Greece in 1920s had about 5.5 million people, the population was that, so they had more than 1 million coming in 2 years. In a country that was already unorganized, the infrastructure, they didn't find the time to organize it, the infrastructure was low or weren't even there, so they have almost 1.5 million people coming. It's not really known about the Creek of Pontus, which is north of Turkey, so they didn't really know what to do. It's really connected to nowadays because we have the same images from refugees in Greece, and the two key players is some of the players is Turkey and Greece, so we have the same image more or less. So this is one newspaper that shows the immigrants that they are standing somewhere and they don't know where to go, because actually the state didn't know what to do with them. So there was it was impossible to handle the refugees, there were so many. So this is one of the beginnings of loaning. So they had to loan a lot of money in order to support all these people. So this is a mentality that continued, and of course you've seen in the news about Greece nowadays. Greeks, local Greeks, didn't really believe that the Greeks from Asia Minor were Greeks, so they didn't, they have this massive gap. Greeks from there, they were really educated, advanced, they were speaking many languages. It took about three decades for them to adjust. The state matured rapidly because they had to, so in a way it helped the country to become what it is today. So there was support from Red Cross or YMCA. I had double. Okay, so these are some of the there is a huge archive of photos, which is really impressive if someone wants to begin. These are from Athens. This is a very great main idea how people were. Of course, it's impressive that there are photos with people that wear very fancy clothes, so they have fur or something like that, because people in Asia Minor, they were advanced, so their clothes were better than the locals. So these are, most of these are in Athens, which is impressive that they're just building small houses or tents. So this is downtown, this is like a kilometer from downtown. So the cultural contribution of Greeks from Asia Minor, it's massive. In the country, they were cosmopolitans. They had better education. They had education because Greeks, they didn't actually have, let's say, the university wasn't built until 1920s in Athens. They knew how to be entrepreneurs, they were businessmen, they knew about banking system, they knew about things that in mainland people were completely ignorant about that. So they really gave a boost to the reality and to put Greece in the modern world, in the Western world. In literature, which is a very, very massive part of the culture, it was impressive. Let's say, for example, this guy, Safaris, is one of the two people in Greece that they got the Nobel Prize, and he was from Asia Minor. One of the main ideas is that, it's food, I don't know if you are hungry, my fellow Turkish neighbor will verify that it is a food culture, and it really connects these two, all the Mediterranean, we don't know how to eat, yes? They introduced languages, this country became a country which, let's say now, most of the people speak at least two foreign languages, which was a culture that introduced by them. Most of the people there spoke, Turkish and Greek, many of them French, so they introduced something that was really different. Culture, music, theater, dance, these were, because many of the of people in Minor Asia, they were connected to Europe or to the United States, so they introduced a new culture. Many of the main theaters, they were organized and promoted by people from there. So some conclusions, I guess I'm on time. It's very important, not only be a lesson not only for this paradigm, but generally about the role of new immigrants or refugees or where they come from in Greek life or in the life of a country. It's impressive that they helped people mature. It is also impressive that they were considered Turkish for at least 30 years, because of course most of the people in Asia Minor, Greeks, they were speaking in their families Turkish as well. It was part of their culture, it wasn't something to leave behind. They created a connected bond between Turkish people and Greek people, because almost, I've read numerous notes for people and so interviews, almost nobody will tell that Turkish people were aggressive or whatever. Everybody talks about politics, so that created two bases, two layers, politics and people. And really, these people always, even if they are too old, they were saying the same thing. I've read people like 19, 5 years old, that they were saying the same thing. Don't do the same mistakes, people. They have nothing to share, which is impressive. And once again, they reminded Greek people the Mediterranean identity. They put them again in the map, in the idea of thinking as Mediterraneans and not only as Greeks. Thank you very much. All the time.